Good morning. I'm first of the two Howards I'll be speaking to you this morning, and clearly I was epigenetically determined to become a genome scientist. I'm also a practicing physician, and so it's really a pleasure to be here to kind of share these great ideas. And in this particular talk, I want to really reduce it to the kind of information we might use in clinical practice. And so the priorities then in some sort of clinical encounter obviously are events that, number one, could potentially have a catastrophic health impact, and number two, something with an imminent time horizon. And third, something that's actionable. And so when we think about the different projects, I'm trying to filter it through these kinds of lenses for information that we can really use in that regard. And so when I think about kind of the impact of NHGRI-funded research has had on health, really the two major impacts are, number one, understanding the genetic basis, the genomic basis of disease, that's the variants, the causal mutations, and number two, really the impact of the technologies that has had on understanding, let's say, the gene regulation in diseased tissues. And that's really identifying a lot of molecular features. This is a very exciting year. We've had already over the last year, several FDA approval for drugs that's based on specific molecular features rather than specific tissues or a generic diagnosis organs. And so those successes come from actually having detailed understanding the molecular basis of disease, and they eventually match up with targeted therapies that were separately developed. So in thinking about this set of problems, this is a slide I borrow from a report from the National Academy of Medicine that makes the analogy between trying to navigate understanding the health space using the electronic maps that we all use in navigating our daily lives. It just makes the simple analogy that the real world is being represented at multiple layers, and each of these layers makes this map more and more useful. And that is the streets, the customers, the businesses. And so when we think about in person, a clinical encounter to coming with a disease problem, really, there are different layers of information, starting, of course, from our genome, to the basis of gene regulation, the chromatin, the many different RNAs that are made, and therefore the different kind of cells, then impacts of perturbations, which are all linked together to create the ultimate phenotype. And so what we've seen in the last few days is really that the scope of the NHGRI technology and capabilities have extended us to really cover more and more of the space. And we can really learn from our genomics and epigenomics information about cell types, states, microenvironment, perturbations, prognosis, and response. And so among the projects that we've discussed at this meeting, I think there are several that I wish to highlight, and I kind of link them to kind of how that might be of impact in the clinical space. First of all, is this project's gotten several names. I think Steve called them a GTEx on steroids. I call it a single cell GTEx. And that is the use of really leveraging ability to the natural variation that exists in the population, both inherited and somatic, as Steve just talked to you, and get a really comprehensive readout of many cells, individual cells from different tissues, from these individuals, RNA, regulatory element activity, and so forth. This could be a number is being thrown out, let's say starting with 1,000 individuals, spanning really the human diversity. And I think you can imagine that this kind of a technology would then go on to also be applied to subjects that are in our variant association studies, for example, GWAS subjects. So not only do you have a link, a polygenic risk score, you also now have, let's say, okay, in association with this polygenic risk score, we know that certain cell types are perturbed, certain cell states are different, and this will be actually far more, very, very informative. We have to make choices, even if we're using our single cell technologies that powerfully deconvolute complex tissues, and I'm going to make a strong pitch for actually working directly with human tissues, that we have to make priorities about which samples might be the most accessible and the most that we can most best pilot our methodologies and performance. And so accessible tissues such as blood, skin, or gut might be good choices. These are also the tissues that we're most able to get from our patients with the least risk. And so these are the kind of samples we can get. And so if your measurements already, discovery were made in those tissues, that would make their later application perhaps more easy. The second sort of set of projects we talked about started from something that Jay proposed, and that is a deperturbational profiling. And that is the idea of requiring proximal molecular readouts of variants at all the transcribed exons, RNA elements, DNA regulatory elements, and perhaps in combination. And I think here we've had many discussions about why this is a good idea, and really the key issue now is how do you do it and at what kind of a scale and depth. And so some of the prioritizations potentially could be that we can actually profile all the, for example, disease SNPs also in combination. And that could actually, again, build you a cell model of, let's say, an individual who has at a certain spectrum of the polygenic risk score. We can fill in the space of the molecular impacts of the variants of unknown significance in known disease genes. Other potential regions to highlight the potential sets of elements connected by high C contacts and or sites of transcribed regions that we know something important is likely going on. For example, sites of specific RNA structure, sites of RNA modifications. And this is something that is worth discussing because I think a lot of thought can go into this. And thirdly, I think something that we talked about quite a bit would be is the technology development front, a single cell multi-omic technologies. This is a sort of a lever that would make all the projects we just talked about actually much more powerful and informative. And this is the idea of acquiring multiple genomic modalities and perturbations, information, or even records of gene expression events from the same single cell. And making this technology robust, making it scalable, and of course, building a computational framework to interpret this information. Thank you.